Thank you, Dr. Wambugu, for that introduction. I also would like to thank Dr. Wala and Grace for having presented an excellent talk on the PD, how to start and how to go about it. And now we're going to talk about how to follow up a patient on peritoneal dialysis. So Dr. Wala has talked about the solute clearance, and we also need to know that patient follow-up on peritoneal dialysis is not just about solute clearance, but other things that are related, many different factors that play a role in the patient's well-being. And recently, the ISPD guidelines talked about goal-directed peritoneal dialysis prescription and not just solute clearance. And the goal direction should be aims to allow the person doing PD to achieve his or her own life goal. So it shouldn't just be what we want, but also should be what the patient wants to achieve, and also to promote high provision of high quality care dialysis. So they actually recommend such a chart, and it's very crowded. But what I want you to look at is what do we consider when we are reviewing these patients? One is their functional status, their social status, how they are feeling, what is their quality of life that they report, what is their residual kidney function, volume status, then other derangements that you find in kidney diseases such as anemia, bone mineral disorders, electrolyte disorders. Nutrition is very important in these patients. Metabolic parameters, they might get an increase in body mass index, lipids, glycemic control. We also want to look at inflammation in these patients. They are at risk of exit site infection, peritonitis, and we want to make sure that their peritoneal membrane is actually functioning well to allow solute clearance as well as ultrafiltration. And all this, we do it with the hope of potential goals of care, and that is improved survival, extend time on peritoneal dialysis, increase quality of life, increase participation in daily life activities. Because we are doing this peritoneal dialysis so that they're not coming to the center all the time. They're able to move on with their life. They are able to work and continue with their normal working lifestyle. Symptom improvement, reduce hospitalization, and prolong residual kidney function. So the PD prescription has to also be a realistic care goal. And one PD prescription does not stand for forever. And you have to keep on changing it according to how your patient is doing. You might find that you might have to increase the number of exchanges. You might have to increase the concentration of the dialysis fluid. You might have to look at what is working for your patient. You have also to look at the local resources. You can't talk about low GDP dialysis fluid when there's none available around. So you must work with what you have. And what does the patient want in terms of lifestyle? The other factor you have to consider is who helps them with peritoneal dialysis. If they need somebody to be around, your prescription also needs to adjust for these people who are also moving on with their lifestyle. They're also working. They might not be at home. And such a situation that we got in Tigerberg Hospital, whereby one of our patients was actually working, and it would come in every time with fluid overload. And we always thought she's not compliant. And the only problem she had was at work. She had no place to actually do her exchanges. There was no sterile place to do her exchanges. So she would always keep one exchange during the day. And by the time she reaches, she's fluid overloaded. And the prescription was never adequate for her. And all it took was finding out why she had this poor compliance to dialysis. And all it took was calling in a private center and asking them if she could come and change, do an exchange during work hours at their place when it was nearby, and she became compliant. We also look at health-related quality of life of these patients, and not just the solute clearance. And a study was done by Tana et al. In South Africa, whereby they looked at the quality of life of patients on PD and HD. They found that overall quality of life was not really different between the two modalities. However, they did find that PD patients had more symptoms, had more insomnia, and HD patients had more issues with continuing with work. The next thing, you want to look at volume status, because we want these patients to maintain clinical euvolemia. And remember that they always have, by the time you start them, they might have some residual kidney function. So by the time we are starting peritoneal dialysis, our prescription might not be targeted to remove everything via the peritoneal dialysis. But as they progress, they are going to lose some of this residual kidney function, and they might need change in terms of the prescription. At the same time, monitoring their blood pressure, because blood pressure can be a guide to fluid status. In terms of residual kidney function, peritoneal dialysis enables us to maintain and preserve the kidney residual kidney function for a longer time. You actually lose around 0.05 to 0.3 ml per minute per month in peritoneal dialysis, which is significantly lower than in hemodialysis. And this residual kidney function is very important for you to know, not just at the beginning, but at every review that you do. You must find out from the patient how much urine they are producing so that you can consider that when making a prescription. Having residual kidney function also allows you to have a less stringent prescription. And even the patients find that the treatment burden is not much, and so they will also comply better. Solute clearance, Dr. Wala has talked about it, about how to maintain a KT over V of 1.7, how you would target it to enable you to have a KT over V of 1.7. But again, if your patient is clinically well, nutrition-wise, volume-wise, and KT over V has not reached 1.7, then it's not always a must to reach there. And go higher in terms of KT over V, and that is according to the new ISPD guidelines in 2020. Always remember that one size doesn't fit all. What will work for me will not work for Dr. Wambogu, will not work for Dr. Wala. There are some people who are older, elderly, who are frail, and they might have a poor prognosis. So trying to be very strict in terms of maintaining solute clearance might not be the best for them. So don't always have a strict protocol that this is what they must do, and modify a dialysis prescription to minimize the burden of disease and symptoms in them. One of the things that happens in PD patients is malnutrition. A Korean study analyzed malnutrition in PD versus HD patients and found that malnutrition was more common in PD patients comparatively to hemodialysis patients. And malnutrition can always be assessed by simple tests or subjective global assessment test. Sorry. Or anthropometric measurements and the hand grip test. These are quite easy. Sorry. These are quite easy tests that can be done. Versus a DEXA scan, which is more expensive. We can also look at the biochemical markers, including potassium bicarbonate and albumin. When talking about albumin as a marker of nutritional status, is quite important. Some people might argue that it's not a good predictor of nutritional status because of increase when there's and is influenced by inflammation, and it tends to go down as inflammation occurs. And it's also influenced by albuminuria in patients who have a residual kidney function and peritoneal albumin losses. It's also affected by hydration status. However, albumin is easily measured. It's one of the routine labs in most centers. And if you look at the registry, South African registry, they actually document albumin levels in all their patients and as a marker of the patient well-being and nutritional status. Studies done by the CANUSA study, the Canadian USA peritoneal dialysis study, showed that a 1 gram per liter decrease in serum albumin was associated with a 6% increase in relative risk of death. So albumin is very important, and it's very important to measure the albumin levels in this patient. Now, in terms of dietary protein intake for these patients, normal recommended dietary protein intake is 1.2 to 1.3 grams per kilogram for body weight. However, peritoneal dialysis patients usually lose a lot of protein, 8 grams per day during the dialysis. And during peritonitis, they actually have a higher loss of protein, and they might require up to 1.5 grams per kilogram for body weight supplementation of proteins during peritonitis. Infections is very common in these patients, and infection can be just exit site infection, tunnel infections, as well as peritonitis, which is more complex. Now, whenever you see these patients, you must look at the catheter site. You must milk it to see if there's any fluid coming out. And if there is, you must take a first swab, start the patient on antibiotic. Peritonitis is very, it's a major concern for PD patients, because it is a major contributor of death in PD patients, up to 16%. And severe and prolonged peritonitis usually leads to alteration of the peritoneal membrane, leading to peritoneal membrane failure. Peritonitis is also a major cause of PD technique failure and conversion to long-term dialysis. So we must find ways to mitigate peritonitis. So the ISPD guidelines recommend that every center that carries out peritoneal dialysis must monitor the incidence of peritonitis. They must also monitor the overall peritonitis rates for specific organism, the percentage of patients per year who are peritonitis free, and the antimicrobial susceptibilities. And based on the antimicrobial susceptibilities, those are the empirical antibiotics you will give according to your center. And what you have found is what kind of organism grow and what is more susceptible. Now, for you to make a diagnosis of peritonitis, you must have at least two of the following. One is that there must be clinical features of peritonitis that could be abdominal pain or a cloudy dialysis effluent. And second, when you measure dialysis effluent white cell count, it must be above 100 per microliter, or you could get a positive culture. However, you will not wait to start your empirical antibiotics as you wait for the culture. You must start on empiric antibiotics according to your antibiogram that is tailored according to your facility. And as you start on the antibiotics, by the time the culture result come out, then you adjust your antibiotic according to the culture result. Peritonitis treatment can usually goes on from 14 to 21 days. There are modifiable risk factors of peritonitis, and you must find ways to avoid peritonitis in these patients. One is the social, you look at smoking, living away from a PD unit, so they are not very compliant with it. Having pets at home also is a risk factor for peritonitis. In terms of medical factors, obesity, depression, low albumin, low potassium level, low vitamin D levels, and invasive interventions can all predispose you to have peritonitis. In terms of dialysis related, how is the patient doing the exchanges? Is there enough training? Was PD a choice the patient had, or is it not a choice? Because if it's not a choice, they will not be very compliant in terms of the aseptic technique. You also look at whether they have what kind of fluids they're using. And you also look at whether they are Staphylococcus aureus carrier status. Now, ISPD looked at ways to reduce peritonitis, and they talked about catheter placement and giving prophylactic antibiotics at the time of catheter placement. Catheter design did not really impact on peritonitis rates. Training programs was important. You must have a proper nursing staff who actually can train them very well in terms of how to do a proper exchanges. And if you find somebody coming with recurrent peritonitis, they need to be retrained all over again. Don't think that they know. You must go through it all again. The connection methods, there's the flush and fill design, which I'll talk about it later. Dialysis solution, really, they didn't find anything for that. exit site care, applying of mupirocin based cream, and prompt treatment of exit site care or tunnel infection, and after and before any procedures such as colonoscopy or gynecological procedures, you must give prophylactic antibiotic. So the flush before fill method is that as you empty your drain, the dwelling drain, you must make sure that before you fill your peritoneal cavity with another amount of fluid, you must make sure that you have actually clamped here and flushed this inside before you start filling it inside the abdomen again. This ensures that the peritonitis rates actually decrease. Now, empirical antibiotic, I have talked about according to my problem, biological susceptibility, and it should cover gram positive and gram negative. And once you get your culture results, you must now narrow down to the appropriate antibiotic, and duration is 14 to 21 days. One of the other things that they actually face is ultrafiltration failure. And this is known by the rule of fours, that is a failure to achieve at least 400 mLs of net ultrafiltration during a 4-hour dwell using a 4.25% dextrose solution. So ultrafiltration failure can occur, and there are four types of ultrafiltration failure that we will go to. So the first one is whereby you have a very highly effective peritoneal surface area, whereby you have, for example, because of the constant glucose exposure, you get a lot of cytokines involved and leading to your new vessel formation. And because there's new vessel formation, there's increased vascular permeability and increased effective surface area of the peritoneal membrane. As a result, there's a rapid dialysate glucose absorption and there's loss of osmotic gradient faster. So in a easy way to understand, it's what Dr. Wala said, it was the high transporter type. But only that this is because of increased neoangiogenesis. So this leads to low UF volume, but very high solute clearance. And if you were to measure the dialysate plasma creatinine ratio, you find it above 0.81. What do you do when you have type 1 ultrafiltration failure? You make sure that you rest the peritoneal membrane. You can opt for neutral pH and low glucose degradation product fluids. There is role of blockade of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, whereby they say that the presence of the RAS system leads to activation of transforming growth factor beta and vascular endothelial growth factor, leading to matrix accumulation. So by blocking the RAS, there is a way that you can increase ultrafiltration in these patients. The type 2 failure is whereby you have low osmotic conductance to glucose, and this is because of functional alteration or to aquaporins. So remember Dr. Wala talked about the 3-4 models whereby we had the aquaporins also. So as aquaporins, water moves to, across aquaporins, there's a phenomena that occurs called sodium sieving. Now, when you have ultrafiltration failure, sodium sieving doesn't occur. And that is why you find that when there's reduced sodium sieving, and you find that the total ultrafiltration in the first 1 hour is less than 26% of the total ultrafiltration, then you will have a type 2 ultrafiltration failure. There have been thoughts about using steroids, and some studies have shown that using steroids increases the presence of aquaporins on the membrane. However, there was also versus the harm that it can cause in these patients. Some people are talking about an aquaporin agonist. There is promising data, but not yet. We don't have anything for now. The third type of ultrafiltration failure is when you lose your effective peritoneal surface area. And this can occur when there's fibrosis or adhesions. So if there's fibrosis and that leads to decreased permeability of the peritoneal membrane, or if there's adhesions which also decrease the effective peritoneal membrane surface area, you actually find that you cannot ultrafiltrate and you cannot even solute clear. Encapsulating peritoneal sclerosis is one of the one of the things that leads to a type 3 ultrafiltration failure. and it's not very common. It's the rate is 0.7 to 13.6 per 1,000 patient years, and it is characterized by bowel obstruction as a result of adhesions. The frequency of encapsulating peritoneal sclerosis increases with duration of on peritoneal dialysis, and patients on peritoneal dialysis for more than 8 years have a higher risk. The treatment for this is we must discontinue peritoneal dialysis and shift to other modality. However, some people argue that maybe there's still role, even though you have shifted the patient to hemodialysis, there might be a role for continuing intermittent peritoneal lavage. And they say this will be aid in the removal of matrix metalloproteinases, which lead to more adhesions, more inflammation. Some suggested the use of immunosuppressive agents such as azathioprine, corticosteroid, MMF, sirolimus, but none was shown to have any effects. Recently, the use of tamoxifen has been shown to have some improvement in the EPS. A study in England showed that the median survival increased in patients who are using tamoxifen versus those who are using immunosuppression alone. And a Netherlands study showed that there was decreased mortality in those groups who used tamoxifen and immunosuppression versus those who are using immunosuppression alone. However, it was not statistically significant. Coming to tamoxifen, we actually had a patient with encapsulating peritoneal sclerosis and started him on tamoxifen. He actually did well, but we could not find data on how long do you continue tamoxifen for. Until now, I don't have the answer. Do you continue it lifelong for tamoxifen in this patient? In some cases of severe encapsulating peritoneal sclerosis, surgical enterolysis might be mandated. Type 4 ultrafiltration failure is whereby there's fluid absorption not via the peritoneal membrane, but from other places. If you have fluid absorption from the peritoneal cavity into the lymphatics and into the local tissues, usually PD must be discontinued in this case. There is some role of bethanecol, which is a cholinergic agent, and it contracts the subdiaphragmatic lymphatic stromata and decreases the lymphatic flow. However, it was used in a small study group. And even though the ultrafiltration improved modestly, there was no change in solute transport. So most people say just discontinue PD. Now, what happens to peritoneal dialysis as you continue? There's technique survival failure. And a study was done in South Africa by Kapembo et al. And they found that as the time goes on, technique survival actually decreases in this patient. So you find that at 1 year, the technique survival was at 80%, but at 5 years, it was up to 40%. And this was the same in, for example, in Mexico, you find a similar result, but you find in developed countries, they had better survival. Is it because they have better, social circumstances in these people, or is it because of others? When you look at this analysis of this subgroups, you find that even the time when they were talking about technique survival, whether was it changed to HD or was it death, some included all types of death as saying that it was technique failure. So there was a bit of differences in how they interpreted it. But in South Africa, the causes of peritoneal dialysis technique failure was mostly peritonitis, and that was frequently at up to 71%. So peritonitis is very important. It's very important to ensure that peritonitis rates are reduced. Now, remember, these patients don't just have those, but they can have other PD-related complications such as hernias. So you must examine the abdomen to see if there's any hernia, there's any leak. They might have catheter migration, kinking, catheter dysfunction. They might have an omental wrap. They might have perforation. It's very important to make sure that they're not constipated. That might predispose them to have a catheter migration or omental wrap. know that these patients also have the kidney disease going on. So they have other related conditions, the anemia, the bone mineral disease, the electrolyte imbalance that also needs to be addressed in these patients. They might have non-PD related complications. They are also having end-stage renal disease. Doesn't mean they cannot get other PD related, non-PD related complication. So they need to be screened for other things also, see them as a whole and not just the dialysis. If you find patients who are not doing well on peritoneal dialysis, and that can happen, you must recognize patients who are not doing well on peritoneal dialysis by clinically seeing the patient, body weight changes, clinical assessment, how is the volume status, how is the solute removal, and how symptoms, how, what they are feeling. And some patients might need to be changed to other modalities of like hemodialysis. At the end of the day, remember PD is a means and not the end. So it's not the end to end stage renal disease. And the only way you can find it an end to the end stage kidney disease is transplantation. So don't forget to insist on transplantation at every time you see the patient, that they must find an end and not a way to survive. There was a study done again in South Africa. I took most of them, I quoted mostly South Africa because in Africa, they are the ones who have the most experience in the peritoneal dialysis. And they found that the technique survival of patients, just like I said previously, decreased with increasing years. And the average length of time on peritoneal dialysis was 17 months. That's barely 2 years. So you have 2 years to find a way to get your patient transplanted. I think that's the end of my talk. Thank you.
Excellent, excellent, Tasneem. That was well covered and well articulated. All right. So let me ask you a more practical question. First of all, in Mombasa, do you have people on PD?
No, we don't have. We don't have patients on PD. The other day, I actually called Grace and asked her, I have a patient who has no access soon. What can I do on peritoneal dialysis? So I don't know. Even I'm facing a bit of problems because my renal nurses don't know anything about peritoneal dialysis. Peritoneal dialysis is carried out by pediatric nurses.
Yeah.
So I'm actually talking to them about doing the same thing as Grace did and going for an ISPD. At least have one proponent of peritoneal dialysis in my unit.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's a question that has come in from an anonymous attendee who asks whether there are any absolute or relative contraindications to PD.
Well, so there are contraindications to PD in terms of one, if the patient doesn't want, you can't really put them on PD because then it will be poor compliance, poor things. You'll get a lot of complications, a lot of peritonitis. Maybe some patients just want to be on HD. Second thing was if you have a hernia that is going on, you must fix the hernia first before you decide to start peritoneal dialysis. But other than that, I don't think there's anything unless there's no way to put it.
What is your experience with HIV and AIDS? And PD. I think he means what is your comment on that?
There's no contraindication for HIV patients to be started on PD. There's nothing that they shouldn't be started on it.
Yes, I think PD is an acceptable modality in HIV, in diabetes, in
fact,
all aspects.
In diabetes, it is very recommended because of the preservation of residual renal function. The autonomic dysfunction that they experience in a hemodialysis, the retinal bleed that they might get in hemodialysis. So PD is actually the best for diabetic patients.